Read two verses from Romans 4, from verse 20. From verse 20, Romans 4. And this is the word of the Lord. This is about Abraham. He did not waver or stagger at the promise of God through unbelief, but he was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God, in verse 21, and being fully persuaded or being fully convinced that what he had promised, that is God, God was also able to perform. Lord, I want to bless your holy name for this word. Lord, I do ask that you speak to our hearts. Give us an ear that is able to receive, and every blockage by the enemy we remove in Jesus' name. Lord Jesus, reign at this time so that you can receive the glory, and the glory can also be received by Father. Spirit of God, welcome and minister to us. It is in Jesus' name I have asked.
Amen.
Amen. Today's message, the title is being fully persuaded or being fully convinced. That is the title of today's message, being fully persuaded. I want to start this message by referring to the common word of God that is known by each one of us, the word that says we walk by faith and not by sight. We walk by faith and not by sight. Now, this is what we are going to look at. And I want to start by saying, it seems very nice to say we walk by faith and not by sight. You know, we love that verse. But you and me know how tough it is to actually walk by faith and not by sight. Now, we are very dependent on walking by sight. We love to walk by sight, including myself. We love to walk by the things that we see. It's not easy to walk by the things we don't see. So we love walking by sight. And when you examine your life, as I have done mine, we discover that there are actually so many areas where we are dependent on sight. We cannot move until we see. Hallelujah. We cannot do it until we see it. Now, that's how we are used to walking by sight. We want to see the things. We are not strong enough where it comes to walking by faith where you are not seeing it. So it is so easy to say we walk by faith and not by sight. We are going to concentrate on what does it mean to walk by sight and how easy it is. And you and me know that we definitely depend lots and lots of time on walking by sight. I follow because I see. I believe because I see. And you remember Thomas, he refused to believe that Jesus was alive, even with the testimony of the rest of the disciples. Every one of the disciples, they told him, Thomas, we have seen him, and he was here. And Thomas, you remember, he said clearly, I will not believe until I see it, until I see his wounds, until I physically see him, I will not believe. You know, we used to laugh at Thomas and think Thomas was a very hard-hearted man, but that is you and me. Did you know that? That's you and me. That's the way we walk. We want to believe only after we have seen. It's not therefore a very easy thing to say walk by faith. We are a people of the flesh. We like to walk by what we see, just like Thomas said, I will not walk by faith, I will walk by what I see. I must see him before I believe. Now, you can see that's a big issue, and you and me, we need to really examine ourselves Are we actually walking by faith? Yes, we have been in the work of God for a long time. We have been in church for a long time. But have we learned what it means to walk by faith and not by sight? Are we still walking by sight? And maybe we don't realize we are walking by sight. Remember, Thomas was a disciple, just like we are disciples of Jesus Christ. And yet, Thomas said, no, I really cannot believe it until I see him. Now, you know that we talk about the death of Jesus Christ, but we never saw it. We never saw Jesus. That is what it means to walk by faith. You are believing in something you have not seen. And that is never easy. Many of us today, we are trapped in this area of sight. We want to see first. But the word of God is the other way around. We must believe first, not seeing first. But this is a big problem where we are completely dependent on sight. Now, by sight I mean we look at the physical evidence that is facing us. And when we look at the physical evidence, we say, well, there is evidence that this thing is not going to work. There is evidence that I will not be accepted. There is evidence that I am sick. And you know, the word of God says, let those who are weak say that they are strong. Amen. So how can you say you are strong and you have the evidence you are weak? In the morning when we wake up, like this morning, we were confessing that we are feeling rather tired, rather lethargic. And yet the word is saying, when you feel like that, then say you are strong. Now the problem is, I have the evidence. My body is feeling very tired. My body is feeling very sleepy. My body is telling me, you better just rest. But then the word is saying, let those who are saying they are weak say that they are strong. So how do you connect these two? I have the evidence that I am weak. The other one says, those who are sick, you say that you are healed. How can I say that and I have a headache? I have a fever. I can feel my joints are aching, my back is aching. So how do I say I am healed and I have the evidence that I am sick, I'm not well? You can see there's a problem there, because we are faced with the evidence, the physical evidence, and it is not easy to simply ignore the evidence. That is where we have a big issue of faith. We talk a lot about faith, but we never come to grips with that point where we reach and we are faced with the physical evidence that tells us, don't you see? Don't you see you can't make it? Don't you know that in your family, nobody makes it to 60? Don't you see in your family, nobody is wealthy? Don't you see in your family, nobody gets married? Now, that's the physical evidence, because it is there. And faith then is opposed by the evidence. The evidence is very, very strong. And today, what the Lord wants to teach us is this. How do we deal with the physical evidence? How do you and me deal with the evidence that is real? How do you deal with the fact that I'm feeling unwell, and then the Lord is saying, you declare you are strong? How do you overcome this physical evidence? What is there a way we can overcome how we feel, for example? I don't know how you are feeling right now. Maybe you didn't feel like you want to come to church. You are feeling kind of tired, but you came anyway. Now, that is the physical evidence I'm talking about. I don't know what you are thinking about tomorrow, or this week, or the month to come, or this year, and you are not seeing anything good. You are simply faced with the physical evidence that is telling you it doesn't look good. You are not going to make it. That's the physical evidence. How do we deal with that? Because if we have a key to dealing with the physical evidence, then we are going to make it. Hallelujah. So that is the issue. We are going to be taught by the Spirit of God a few things concerning how to overcome the physical evidence. And The verses I have just read for you in the book of Romans 4, verse 20, 21, it gives us the story of Abraham. And the case of Abraham is going to illustrate to us the physical evidence versus faith. Now, what about Abraham then? These two verses are telling us something very, very unique. First, Abraham was given a promise. Now, you and me, we have been given many promises. I have been given many promises by God. Now, what we do with that promise matters a lot, and it will depend on how we deal with the physical evidence. So we will look at Abraham. Here is Abraham, and he is promised by the Lord, I am going to make many descendants out of you. They will be like the stars of heaven, or like the sand by the seashore. So that is the promise of God. But then there were difficulties. And Abraham saw these difficulties. He looked at his age, and he was old. You know the story. He was nearly 100 years. That was an obstacle, and he could not ignore that. He knew he was old, and then Sarah was old, and her womb was dead according to the Bible. And here, God is promising Abraham descendants as many as the sand of the sea or as the stars of heaven. And the obstacle is this. Abraham and Sarah did not have their own child. And then God tell Abraham, I am going to give you descendants as many as the stars. How do you connect these two things? Here is the age factor. That is a fact. That is the physical evidence. Age is a factor. And many of us, maybe we have reached this stage where age is catching up with us, and we still don't see the fulfillment, hallelujah, of the promise of God. We don't see it. And yet, you and me, we are not getting younger. We are getting old. And we don't see the promises of God being fulfilled. Perhaps you are given a word from the Lord that said, you are going to be a wealthy person, or you are going to be this. But you look at yourself, and you tell yourself, I'm growing old. When is this thing going to happen? You begin to be faced by the same physical evidence Abraham was faced with. Age. Sarah's womb was dead. She was past the age of bearing children. And here is God the Father with this promise. I am going to make out of you descendants as numerous as the stars of heaven. Now, what did Abraham then do to these obstacles? Because he was childless and the age had already caught up with him and with Sarah. How did Abraham handle this evidence? Because it is the real evidence. Let's be very clear. When we talk about evidence, it is real. It's not something we are imagining. When you say you have a headache or you have a fever, that is real. When you feel you are weak, your body doesn't feel like it wants to do anything, that is real. And if the Lord is telling you, let those who say they are weak say they are strong, so how do you connect this feeling of weakness and what God is saying that you confess that you are strong? It is real evidence. And what Abraham did, he did not ignore it. He looked at it. Maybe someone is sick somewhere, a family member, and you don't see a way out. Maybe you are feeling discouraged and disappointed because things have not been happening, and these are real facts. Maybe your life is still down there, and you have the promises of God that tell you, you are going to be a head and not a tail. I am going to bless you. And you are still down there like Abraham. You are, in a sense, experiencing age in that sense, and you don't see as if this promise is going to take place. So these are real facts. And Abraham looked at these facts squarely. And he said, yes, I know, I am old. I know my wife Sarah has passed the age of bearing children. I know that. Now, what do you know about the circumstances facing you? What do you know about your body? Are you still experiencing weakness? Are you still experiencing sickness? Have you been praying for family members and you're not seeing anything? So, have you considered the facts that are facing you? Because Abraham looked at himself and he looked at Sarah and he realized, these are the facts. I am old, Sarah is old, she cannot bear a child. And here is God. He is you telling Abraham, I am going to make many descendants out of you. So there are two things we are going to comprehend today if we look at Abraham's story. He looked at his condition and he accepted the fact that he was old and Sarah was old. He accepted that. It's like saying you go to the doctor and he diagnoses an issue with you and there's nothing you can do about it. It's a fact. You know, when the doctor says you have this, it is a fact. And you can prove it by the way you are feeling. So Abraham considered this. And he said, well, here I am old, and Sarah is old. But the word tells us this. After Abraham looked at his age, and the age of Sarah, and the impossibility of bearing a child, we are told this. That Abraham, after considering these obstacles, he looked at then at the promise God gave to him that I'm going to multiply you. And what Abraham did is this, and this is one of our lessons today. Abraham said, this is the evidence that I am old and Sarah is old. There is an impossibility of getting a child at this age. He looked at that. Then he turned his eyes to the promise of God. And this is what he determined. Which is greater? Is it the evidence or the word of God? Ask yourself, what is more powerful? Is it how I feel or is it what God says? You are not ignoring the fact that you are feeling weak, you are feeling sick. You are not ignoring that. The question is, God has spoken something like he spoke to Abraham and said, I'm going to make descendants out of you many. So what Abraham did was to look at what God is saying. You know, you and me, we have the word of God. He has said many things and even today he has been speaking and he is still going to speak words exactly like the way he talked to Abraham. And Abraham turned his eyes. He set his eyes on the promise of God. Hallelujah. In other words, this is what Abraham did. He looked at the negatives. He looked at the impossibilities. Then he looked at the word, the promise of God. And what did he do? He turned his back to the obstacles. Remember, he's not ignoring them. He knows they are there. But what he did was he set his eyes on the promise of God. That is where he got his victory. Simply by setting his eyes on what God is saying. That's the first thing. Remember, you may be at the moment in a very difficult situation. I may not know what you are looking at or what your life has been like. And at the time you feel like you don't see anything good. It's like you want just to give up. It's okay to consider the evidence. Because Abraham considered the evidence. But then he said, the evidence is there, but it is not greater than the promise of God. It is not greater than what the Lord is promising me. So you can either decide to set your eyes on the evidence, or you can decide to set your eyes on the promise God has given to you. Until you do that, the evidence is going to draw us back. But when you decide, well, that is the evidence, But then this is the promise. This is what God is telling me, and I choose then to set my eyes on the promise of God. That is the first step Abraham took. The Bible says he did not consider his body that was as good as dead. He did not consider Sarah's womb, which was as good as dead. He did not consider. In other words, the word is saying he didn't think that those things were greater than the promise of God. In other words, the evidence is not greater than the truth God was speaking to Abraham about. The promise that God was going to multiply him, to Abraham, it seemed something great compared to the evidence. So he decided, I am going to set my eyes on the evidence, not on the impossibilities. Now, that is the first key step to understanding how do we deal with the evidence that is facing us. Maybe you are in school, and maybe you have done a few tests and you didn't do very well. That is the evidence. It is telling you, you may fail. But if the Lord has promised, I'm going to see you through, you need to look at the evidence of the papers you have done and you didn't do very well, and set your eyes on the promise of God that says, I'll see you through. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That is what we are talking about. The evidence is there. You are not ignoring it, but you are deliberately choosing to believe what God is saying. That is where we have a big problem. We still set our eyes on the evidence. Look at your children. You look at them and you may think, well, my children, they seem to be so low down there. I don't know how they are going to make it. I don't know how they will reach the top. Maybe in school they are not performing very well. And you look at them and you are so discouraged because you don't see them making it to the top. And maybe some of us, as we rear these children, we look at the future and we can't see much for these children of ours. We don't see greatness. Yet, there are so many promises in the Word of God that says, I'm going to bless you and your seed. And you will need to look at the evidence. How are your children like? When you see the negative thing about your children, they are not really making it very well. If you dwell there, you will tie yourself down. The alternative is to look at the evidence that the kids are not doing too well, but you look at what God is telling you, that I'm going to make these kids very great.
Amen.
So there are many areas in our lives where we are still looking at the evidence instead of the Word of God. What is the Word of God telling us? The second thing I want you to see that is mentioned in the second part, verse 21, is this. The Word of God says, after Abraham looked at the evidence and he decided, well, the evidence is not greater than the Word of God. It is not greater than the promise. I tell you, if you can hold this, you got something. You look at the evidence and say, than the promise. And the second thing Abraham did, we are told in verse 21. We are told he was fully persuaded, he was fully convinced that the one who had the promise has the power to do it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. This is what the Lord is telling us today. We need to reach that point where Abraham reached, where we are fully persuaded, we are fully convinced that the one who has promised has the power to do it. And today, you know, God has fulfilled and is continuing to fulfill the promise that he made to Abraham, that Abraham would be the father of descendants like the stars of the sea. You know, the stars of the sky. And you know, you and me, if we walk in the faith of Abraham, we are Abraham descendants. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm.
You are a descendant of Abraham. I am a descendant of Abraham by faith. All those who walk in the faith of Abraham, we are called his descendants. Think about how many believers in the world are today. And before the Lord returns, we are going to see much, much more as the Lord continues to purify his church. I don't want to divert a lot, but I want to tell you this. As we come nearer to the return of Jesus Christ, hallelujah, there is a transformation that God is going to perform in the churches. He is going to separate the wind and the wheat. And when he has separated the wheat, that wheat which is the true believer, the church will be very different. It will be a very powerful church. It will have the love that is of Christ himself. Because the church must be pure before the Lord returns. He is not coming for a flawed church. He is coming for a church that is ready. A church without wrinkles, without spots. So we have to reach that point where the church is clean. That is why, hallelujah, he is cleansing you and me every day. He is preparing his clean church. Now, when you look then at the case of Abraham, there are two things we have learned. That Abraham looked at the promise of God and he concentrated there. He set his eyes on the promise of God. The second thing he did was to look at the power of God. And he said he was fully convinced that God who had promised him had the ability to fulfill that promise. So how do you and me then handle the negatives? How do you handle the evidence that is facing you today? Maybe you came here feeling rather low, feeling very negative about things because you have not seen as yet the goodness of the Lord in your life. You have not seen the promises being fulfilled. What do you do then now to overcome the physical evidence? What do you do, like Abraham, to overcome something that is very definite? You are looking at yourself and you don't think much of yourself. How do you overcome that? Now we have the example of Abraham. The first thing I want to show you is this. The word of God says this about Abraham. After Abraham decided, well, that is the physical evidence of my age and Sarah's age and the impossibility of bearing a child. That is the physical evidence. He looked at that. Then he looked at what God was telling him, I am going to give you many descendants. And he set his eyes there. The next thing we are told is this, that Abraham did not stagger. Abraham did not waver. After he had decided, the physical evidence is there, but I choose to set my eyes on the promise of God. The next word says, he did not stagger with unbelief. Hallelujah. He did not waver. You know, to stagger is to doubt. And unfortunately, we, including myself, how many times have we staggered in our faith? How many times are we defeated by the physical evidence? Many times we have been praying to be healed, but we continue to be afflicted by sickness one after the other. And you reach a point where you ask the Lord, where is the divine health you have promised? You have said it is the portion of those who believe you. It is the heritage of every child of God. Yet now and then we are hit by sicknesses. Why then do we stagger when we keep on getting sick and we forget to set our eyes on the promise of God that he is the Lord, the healer? Do you see how many times we stagger? Sometimes it is in the area of finance. We don't have enough. We are pressed sometimes by debts. Sometimes it's something to do with our relatives or our children or our spouses. There are some negative things, and we reach a point because this thing keeps on going on. it doesn't seem to be solved, we reach that point where we are overwhelmed by the physical evidence. Mm. And we stagger at that point. We waver, and belief gets hold of us, and unlike Abraham, we stagger. To stagger, as I say, is you are not steady. Like a person who is drunk, you are not steady. And the word tells us, despite the age of Abraham, and despite the age of Sarah, despite the fact that Sarah's womb was no longer capable of conceiving, Abraham, after considering that and looking ahead to the promise of God, the word says he did not stagger with unbelief. I don't know whether we came here this morning, we have been staggering with unbelief. We know a lot. We know the promises of God. But because the issue of time seems to be so long, we have come to a point where we are staggering. We are wavering. Did God say it? Is this word true? And we begin to stagger because we are not seeing any progress with the issue that is facing us. Perhaps that is where you are. Perhaps that is where I am. Where I am faced by the physical evidence and I have begun to stagger. My brother and my sister, hear the word of the Lord. Do not stagger. The evidence is overwhelming. Just like it was overwhelming for Abraham. But we are told he did not stagger with unbelief. He did not waver. He did not doubt even for a second about the promise of God. So, in order to avoid staggering, what do we do? What are you going to do about it in order to come back to your faith in the promise of God? What are you going to do to stop that staggering, to stop that doubt? What you and me need to do is exactly what Abraham did. You set your eyes on the promise of God. Don't look at the evidence. It is there. But look at the promise. What has God said to you? Many of us, we have reached where we are, hallelujah, because there was a promise of God over our lives and it has happened. We didn't have a job and we have a job. We did not have enough education. Some of us are going even farther than we imagined. It is because we have not staggered.
Amen.
And the only way you can avoid staggering or doubting God is to set your eyes on the promise. Amen. Let me put it this way. Let us remember the case of Zacharias. You remember Zacharias, the father of John.
Yes.
When the angel talked to him in the temple, and he told him, you are going to have a son, and you are going to call him John. And unfortunately for Zechariah, he was overwhelmed by the physical evidence. He looked at himself and he looked at Elizabeth. And he said, but God, don't you know we are very old? Can you imagine telling God that? God, you do realize we are very old. Therefore, what you are saying is impossible. That's what Zechariah said. Lord, oh, you are telling me this? I'm telling you, as Zechariah, that is impossible. Because I am very old and my wife is very old. But listen to what the angel was speaking to Zechariah. He only told Zechariah, not only are you going to have a son, I am giving you his name. His name shall be John. And further than that, I am telling you what John is going to do. Now, can you imagine, here is the man, and he is not listening to the promises of God. What is he doing? He is looking at the physical evidence. Hallelujah. He is looking at himself and his wife. And his eyes are set on the impossibility of what God is saying. Hallelujah. He is not looking at the promise of God. He is not setting his eyes on the promise of God like Abraham. He is simply living in the physical evidence, and therefore, for him, it was impossible for the promise of God to be fulfilled. Now, you know, he was struck with numbness. He was unable to speak because he doubted. Now, that is what we are talking about. And many of us, what we are doing, we are more like Zacharias. The Lord is telling us, you are looking at yourself. You are belittling yourself. You are looking at yourself and you do not think you are going to anybody. You will never get a good job. You are looking at yourself and you see you can never reach that level where you are getting enough money from a job. You are looking at that overwhelming evidence. While the word of the Lord is telling you, I am the source of all riches. I will make you great. And I have a wonderful plan for you.
Amen.
You are looking at yourself and the evidence that is facing you, and you are accepting it exactly like Zacharias. So what is the solution? Zacharias staggered with unbelief. But Abraham did not stagger. What did Abraham do, which is so special? What he did was he said, well, this is the physical evidence, my age and Sarah. But I am not going to be governed by that evidence. I choose to believe what God is telling me. Therefore, the word says, he did not stagger. Why? Because he set his eyes on the promise. Why am I talking about the promise? It is because if you set your eyes on the promise, you will begin to see how great the promise is. Hallelujah. You will compare the greatness of the promise and compare with the negative evidence, and you will surely reach a point where you say, this promise of God is overwhelming. Imagine Abraham was being told, you don't have a son, your own son with Sarah. But I'm giving you descendants which you cannot count. They will be like the stars of the sea. Now you compare how great that promise is. That is where we need to set our eyes on the greatness of everything God has said in his word. Has he said, I am the Lord your healer? Imagine if you put your trust in that and say, although I feel sick now and then, there is still the greatness of this promise that the Lord is surely my healer. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You may be feeling very low and looking down at yourself, but you turn your eyes to what God says in his word and begin to see the greatness of the promise, the overwhelming greatness of the promise. Because the promise of God is always overwhelming. It goes beyond the physical evidence that is facing us. A long time ago, and I have said it before, the Lord said to me, you will not lack. And that time, as I have said before, we didn't have much. We still remember that. Because my wife had more money than me. She had $8 in the bank. And I had $5 in the bank. And that is the time the Lord was saying, you will not lack. Now, here is the physical evidence. The money in the bank. That is a fact. I had $5, she had $8. And here the Lord is telling me, you will not lack. Now, if we had set our eyes on the $13 in the bank, instead of seeing the greatness of what God is saying, we would have missed it. But the greatness of God's promise is this. When he says you will not lack, he means exactly that. He means in your bank, in your account, you will be amazed when the Lord fulfills that promise, how much money will be in your account. That is what it means. You will not be looking at $5 or $8 which we had. You'll be looking at lots and lots of money. There were times the Lord had said, I will send people and you will find money coming into your account. You will not know where it is coming from. Yes. I want to tell you the truth. This thing is happening. It has been happening for the last few years. We have no idea how the money comes to the account, although eventually we know, but it comes. We did not know, we did not plan it. Now, this is what we are talking about. We are being limited by the physical evidence. We must look at the greatness of the promise. Hallelujah. When the Lord says, I will provide, He means you will not lack anything. But see the way we struggle to try and make ends meet. Why? Because we are limited by the physical evidence. We are too much like Zechariah. We still are saying, but Lord, that is impossible. Maybe you really look down on yourself. You don't see yourself as a great person because you are still down there. Now, if that is limiting you, you need to switch your eyes from yourself. Set your eyes on God. Set your eyes on the greatness of what God tells you. I know there are some people here who received a word that they will become wealthy. And I don't want to mention the name, but we have one person, one family. And I remember the word spoken to that family that the Lord is saying, I am going to make you wealthy. It did not take many years. This family today, they moved from here. They went to Alabama. This family is doing tremendously well in fulfillment of the word. But do you know what these people did? Particularly the man. He turned his eyes from being where he was in a low-paying job. And what he did, he said, that word has come from God, I believe it. And he set his eyes on the promise. Today they are reaping from that word. Hallelujah. And that is what Abraham did. He looked at the physical evidence and he said, but on the other side, there is the greatness of the promise. Many of you have been told something in this church. Many of you have read a word in the scripture. And you know what that word is saying. You know what it is promising you. I tell you today, you set your eyes on the greatness of the promise. It will surely come to pass. The second thing we need to do to defeat staggering, not only do we need to set our eyes on the greatness of the promise, you look at how big it is going to be. You look at that and then say, well, what God has said is really something. I would rather go for that. And rather than look at the negative evidence, I'm going to look at what God is telling me because it is very great. That's the first part. The second part is this. Like Abraham, you and me, hallelujah, you and me, we must begin to consider the power of God. We must begin to see God in His ability to bring to pass everything that He says. I believe we have belittled God a lot. We look at God and we have made Him look like a human being. You know, the way human beings are stingy. They are not able to give. We have limited God's ability, the creator of the universe, the one who owns the earth and everything that is in it, and we have reduced Him to a man or a human being. And yet, Abraham said this. He was fully persuaded that God has the ability to do what He had promised. When you begin to think about the power of God, when you begin to think about His ability to do things, and you remember such words that say, is anything too hard for God? When you begin to switch your eyes now to the ability of God, I'm telling you, we can defeat staggering.
Amen.
Just like Abraham did, he said, well, it is God the Almighty who has promised it.
Yes.
Now, to you and to me, every promise you have, who has promised it? It is the one who has the power to make it happen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That is why when you are called for an interview, and it is a job you know it is so important, and there are maybe hundreds of people who are competing for that job, when you receive the word of the Lord that says, I'll cause you to prosper if you trust me, if you live by faith, I'm going to prosper you. When it comes to the interview, because God is able, what he does is to remove everybody else. And he says, this is my child. This is the job for my child. And you get that job. That is what it means when you begin to switch your eyes to the ability of God to do what he has promised. Therefore, you and me, we have two powerful reasons not to stagger. I don't know whether you came today and you have been staggering in some areas of your life, but we have two powerful lessons today that tell us we have a way out by which we can defeat staggering. One is to switch our eyes to the greatness of the promise. And secondly, is to know and to realize the ability of God to fulfill things. He has fulfilled so many things in our lives. A few weeks ago, we were given a testimony here of someone who went to the immigration, and lo and behold, God arranged it in such a way that he met somebody who is from our place. And because of that, there was no procedure. Everything was granted that takes months. It was granted right there. That is what we are talking about, the ability of God to do what he has promised. I do recall the word spoken over that person's life here, that the favor of God will be there. Hallelujah. And truly, when he went, the favor of God worked in his favor. And within minutes, everything time to reach that point. The ability, the power of God to do what he has promised. I am appealing to you and to myself by the Spirit of God. Let us turn our eyes to the ability of God to do what he has promised. Do not be put down by continuous sickness and say, well, I keep getting sick. You look at your own members, they keep on messing you up. You look at the children, they don't seem to be improving. Don't be trapped there. Look at the ability of God that he is able to get you out of there. He is able to make your children great. He is able to make you great. And finally, this is not just a message for all of us. This is a message that is directed to the fathers. Especially today being Father's Day. This is what the Lord is saying. Do not stagger as fathers.
Amen.
Do not look at the discouragements you have gone through. Maybe in your own house, maybe with the families, maybe in your place of work. The word of the Lord says, do not stagger, fathers. And because he loves each one of us, he says, set your eyes on my ability to do things for you. Let me say this then to every father who is here. This is the Lord saying something special to the father. This is your word. And the Lord says, if you set your eyes on my ability to fulfill that which I have promised, if you do not stagger in your faith, guess what the Lord is going to do? The way he made Abraham great is the way he is going to make every father great.
Amen.
We need to set an example to our families. Like Abraham set an example to his family and he became the father of many nations. When you do not stagger because your eyes are set on the promises of God and you have come to grasp the wonderful understanding of the ability of God to do things, when you do that, the Lord will take you to places you never even imagined as a father. Your children, your spouses, they will truly look at you. They will say, my father is a man of great faith. My husband is a husband of great faith. Why? Because he does not stagger. He has held on to the promise of God. Let me say this. The families are looking up at every father. The greatest gift the Lord can give us today is what he gave to Abraham when Abraham did not stagger. The greatest gift is to know that the one you have been serving, he is going to fulfill every promise he has spoken of in his word. You will truly stand out as Abraham stands out. This is the word of the Lord to every father. Do not stagger. Hold on to the promises of God. Look at the greatness of these promises. And again, this is a word to each one of us. You have been staggering. Do not stagger. Let us walk after the faith of Abraham. Let us take God in his majestic power to bring to pass every word that he has promised. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord continue to reveal this mystery of this word. May the Lord grant us the faith that is able not to consider the testimony of the evidence, but a faith that is able to hold on to the greatness of the promises of God. May the Lord open our eyes to understand who he is, his ability to fulfill everything that he has promised in the word. May the Lord then hold you with his right hand and guide your steps. May he bring into fulfillment the desires of your heart. May he bring peace in your family. May he bring greatness in your own family. May he lift up your children to cause them to be mighty in his service. May the good shepherd then shepherd you throughout this week. May his favor rest on you squarely as it rested on Abraham. May the Lord then multiply you, and may you expand to the south and to the north and to the east and to the west. May the Lord grant you good health together with your children and your spouses. May the peace of God reign in your hearts and in your mind throughout this week. It is in Jesus' name I have prayed, and everyone say,
Amen.
Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore.
Amen.
Amen. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.